Welcome, thank you for the nice introduction. Yesterday, you saw several talks that discussed the concerns about ionizing radiation. And in 2007, in JAMA, there was one article that really brought to attention the concern of radiation exposure for cardiac CT. In this study, using the technology at the time, which was for a cardiac exam, which was fully retrospectively gated, the lifetime risk of developing a cancer from a single cardiac CT for a young female was 1 in 143. Based on some of these, some of this work, industry has improved what we can do in terms of reducing radiation exposure. Earlier this year in the New York Times, there's perpetually articles about radiation exposure, and it's also in the medical literature, such as Lancet, about the dangers of radiation exposure. As you know, with the Aquilion One technology, you can image the whole heart or a whole organ at one time due to the wide detector technology. In essence, we can image the heart within one heartbeat. If you don't have a wide volume scanner, you will have misalignment or stair-step artifacts. There'll be banding artifacts, and patients will have to hold their breath for a longer time. With a wide detector, you have temporal uniformity. You know, this is a single heartbeat scan. It's a fraction of a heartbeat. There's no misalignment artifacts, no stair-step artifacts. And because the image quality is better, you're able to translate from anatomy to physiology. And I'll go over that in a couple slides. At the NIH, we're very fortunate to have delivery of the second Aquilion One Vision that was produced. And we've been using the scanner routinely for cardiac use since July 2012. Here's two pictures of it being installed. So what I'll describe is our initial cardiac experience using the Aquilion One Vision scanner for doing cardiac work. Whenever I talk about radiation dose, I like to frame it in terms of the patient population. As you know, in the U.S., unfortunately in the U.S., we're leading the obesity epidemic, but this is really a worldwide epidemic where people are getting bigger and bigger. And one nice feature of the Aquilion One Vision is that it's a wider bore, 78 centimeters, and it has a larger X-ray generator, so it has have more photon flux to image larger patients. If you look at the patient size that we see at the NIH, a majority of the patients are overweight or obese. Almost two-thirds of the patients are in that category. And when we first summarized our experience, we did not exclude anybody. We took all clinical cases that were referred for a cardiac CT. So we included people who were morbidly obese. Here's one example image. So this is a patient who has a BMI of 45, morbidly obese. She's a 70-year-old lady who was referred to determine if she had ischemic cardiomyopathy. She had heart failure, and the referring doctors wanted to know if she had obstructive coronary disease. Well, from the scout images, you can clearly see that she's large, but she also had arthritis of her right shoulder and could not move it out of the field of view. So we had to scan her with the arm down. And this is the image call that we got. It's not the prettiest image, but it's completely diagnostic. So overall, when you do cardiac imaging, the goal is to do a one-beat scan, because then you don't have any segmentation errors. And this is a display of the different heart rates that we scanned. So we excluded nobody. These are all comers that came to be scanned with cardiac. So a majority of heart rates are low, but there are patients with faster heart rates, above 70, above 80, and our fastest heart rate was 95, and I'll show you an image of that shortly. So overall, 95% of the scans could be done as a single heartbeat scan. So here's an example. So this is a patient with a heart rate of 95, and this was a two-beat acquisition, and this is the image call that you get. And you were able to stop cardiac motion because with the vision scan with the gantry rotation time of 275, we're able to freeze cardiac motion. If patients have arrhythmias, it's not a problem.
The scanner has arrhythmia detection, and in this case, this patient has a fast heart rate of 87, but also has premature ventricular contractions. And the scanner automatically adapts the exposure window to get a diagnostic scan. So here's a young lady who got referred to evaluate for anomalous coronary arteries. And most patients, when they get the contrast injection, get a little bit warm. She, however, screamed. And you can see that in the lung windows that there is motion. On any other scanner, this would be a non-diagnostic scan. However, this was a single heartbeat acquisition and coronary motion is stopped. By having a larger X-ray generator, we're able to shift imaging towards 100 kV, closer to the K edge of iodine, and then have better attenuation by the contrast. So we're now able to do predominantly 100 kV imaging. And because we're able to do 100 kV imaging, we're also able to get low doses. So here's a patient who, with a BMI of 36, which is obese, and we're able to get a sub-millisievert scan. This is a 0.7 millisievert scan done at 100 kV. So overall, our median radiation dose for all comers for cardiac work was less than a millisievert, 0.93 millisieverts. More than half of the scans, 55% of the scans were sub-millisievert. But what I have to remind you is that this was all comers. These are people who are obese. These are people with fast heart rates. This included people with arrhythmias, people with bypass surgeries, cases where we had to do both LV function and coronary evaluation. So this is not just a coronary evaluation. This is all comers. No one was excluded. To just put that in context, this was a survey of 50 sites doing cardiovascular CT in 2009. And this was across all vendors. Each line is an individual site. The black line is their median radiation dose, and then the error bars. And what's impressive is that across all vendors, there's a huge amount of variability, but within one site, there's also a huge amount of variability on how much radiation dose is delivered to their patients. If you put this in context with what is achievable with the Equilium One Vision, you're able to do a very low radiation doses and do it very consistently. Here's an example. This is an ultra low dose scan. This is a 0.17 millisievert scan. In a normal sized patient, the BMI is 21. This is not an anorexic patient. And when you talk about dose, you have to put that in context. You don't want to lower the dose to such a level that you miss disease. So here's an example. Here's a circumflex. There's a high-grade stenosis here in the circumflex. It could be a subtotal. There's some contrast distally. In the LAD, there's calcified and non-calcified plaque and looks non-obstructive. So this patient subsequently had an invasive angiogram. And there's a very high correlation into what we see non-invasively with CT versus a reference standard of invasive catheterization. So here's a case that was actually referred to me from an outside hospital. This is a patient who was discovered to have a 7-centimeter aorta, obviously as a surgical size. They did an invasive angiogram to determine if they have obstructive disease. During the invasive catheterization, they were unable to cannulate the coronary arteries. And subsequent to the, it was basically a non-diagnostic invasive angiogram. They subsequently did a cardiac CT at the outside institution. The patient's heart rate was 78, but it was non-diagnostic due to coronary motion. The patient got referred to me, and this is a scan. So this is a heart rate of 80, and this is completely diagnostic. I can confidently exclude obstructive coronary disease in this patient. So this patient just needs an aortic root repair, does not need a combined root repair with bypass surgery. You can also do full cardiac function exams. We don't do it very often, but patients who have pacemakers or metallic implants that prevent them from having a cardiac MRI can have a full volumetric assessment of their ventricular function. So here's an example of a patient with a pacemaker. The other week, I got sent a scan to review. This is also a patient with a pacemaker using a different type of technology. This was off a 64 slice scanner. And I will show you here the image quality from the two different scans. So the image on the top is off an Aquilian 1, the one on the bottom is off a 64 slice scanner. Can anyone guess what the dose is for the 64 slice scanner for a full cardiac function exam? This was a 33 millisievert full cardiac function exam. You can do on the Aquilian 1 a full cardiac function, as in that top image. Here's the dose page, to keep me honest. The DLP was 14.5, so that is a 0.2 millisievert full cardiac function exam. If you look at the difference between the two, that's 150-fold difference in amount of radiation. Now, if you need to look at both coronaries and cardiac function, you can do that. So this is a dose-modulated exam. So it ramps up high at diastole to evaluate coronaries and then ramps low for the rest of the cardiac cycle. And here, you can. This is a patient with apical hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Now, one limitation with cardiac CT is calcification. You get a lot of blooming artifact. In this image here, there are multiple areas of calcification. On the invasive angiogram, those are only one significant stenosis. Coronary stents are also a problem, very similar to dense calcification. And we know from the CORE 64 trial that CTA is ineffective for ruling out significant coronary disease if you have severe coronary calcification. I'll admit that sometimes you get lucky. So this is a patient with a calcium score of over 4,000. Many people would not proceed with a cardiac CT knowing that the calcium score was over 4,000. This patient was imaged on the vision scanner and is completely diagnostic. And I can tell you that this is not a stent. This is native coronary calcification. It's completely diagnostic. And it's less than a millisievert. It's a 0.77 millisievert scan. Thank you for your attention.